What's going on, guys? We're back. It's Star Wars Celebration is done, complete, finito, and we are back. It is Collider Jedi Council, and what a council we have today. Man, there are two of us that were at Celebration to talk about everything on the floor, and there were two that were knee-deep in it, watching everything go down from the home front, and let's talk to one of those people. It's the Smith Lord. Tiffany Smith is here.
I got an email that said I could watch Star Wars Rebels with them, and I showed up here, and no one was here.
No, yes, he's
because they were all in Orlando at Celebration.
The good news is that we did get to watch the first episode of season four. What'd you think? Oh wait, right next to her, it is Mr. Mark Yodi Riley, the number one contender for the Schmodown Championship.
Oh well, thank you. I did not go to Celebrations.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, someone who he and I are brothers on the battlefield because we did go. It's Mr. Ken Knapsack. Kylo Ken, what up, Ken?
I'll tell you right now, that pile of towels and rags is Maydeen. I've been studying it for hours.
I like that.
That, of course, was a reference to our buddy Pablo Hidalgo, which, by the way, and we bring this up right now, Pablo had said something along the lines of, if you think that this this thing of cloths and rags is Nadine, why don't you ask Reddit or Collider? And I reached out to Pablo. I was like, we didn't piss you off, dude. He's like, no. We get tagged in the same post all the time. So that's why I wanted to include it. So I was like,
I can make a case for that pile of rags being Maydeen. I can.
It's very possible.
But you don't want to piss off Pablo. So.
No. I'm going to keep it to myself.
All right, Kenneth, what do we got?
Hey, well, first we're going to round up and kind of recap Star Wars Celebration, which went off last weekend in Orlando. It was a big, wonderful event. This just keeps getting bigger every year, which kind of sucks that they're not doing it next year, but it's probably to regroup for 2019. Christian, there's a lot to talk about, but let's talk about those hot dogs.
Okay. The Nathan's hot dogs were pretty good.
We're good.
I'll tell you what, because I remember convention hot dogs. I'll tell you.
Not the best.
No. And I was starving, and I had to get to an Austin Tack thing, yeah. And I was like, yeah, fine, Ken did it. He doesn't care about it, about his well-being, but I'll go and I'll try it. And it was decent. So thank you for everybody over at Nathan's. We're not sponsored by them. But what we should say, the same thing that we did last year for Celebration, is kind of a roundup and just what we thought of it.
Yeah.
Now, this year being on the floor and seeing I actually think that the news hit even better than the floor did. And I liked the floor very much. I didn't get to spend as much time on the floor as I would have hoped to, but the things that I did see, I liked very much. I've talked to other people that have went, that have covered from the media, and the thought seems to be the same. And I think you and I even spoke about this. A lot of the media was like, well, I don't necessarily know if you needed to be there to get the news. Well, no, of course you didn't need to be there, but that's the whole point, is we wanted to see them stream this thing and give everyone a chance who's not there, but it did add a lot being there. I disagree 100% because, yeah, you could have watched and enjoyed the 40-year anniversary panel as Mark Riley did and other people did, but that's a once-in-a-lifetime experience, man, to be sitting there at the 40-year panel. Curtains open up and there's John Williams playing. I go to try to see him every time he's at the Hollywood Bowl. That was an experience to be there for. The other thing, and it is still something to say, I mean, you can say the same thing about The Force Awakens if you want, that, oh yeah, you could have watched the trailer from your house and been fine, and maybe that's the case, but being in that room and being in that room of Last Jedi was something special. And I think that this is where there's only a couple things I don't think that they delivered on, but they're very, very minuscule. I think that as far as the feature film news and the things that I thought they were going to do, they hit it. I think that the opening of that 40-year anniversary panel, and I had a couple predictions right, I had a couple predictions wrong. George Lucas did show up, Harrison Ford did show up, but Dennis Lawson was not there. They didn't announce any Obi-Wan stuff or anything along those lines, but it was a good way to kick it off. Tiffany, from someone who, you watched it, some of this stuff after, like,
yeah,
recently, right?
Yeah.
And not even during.
So I wasn't at Star Wars Celebration. I know I was getting a lot of tweets from you guys. So I know, Riley, it's okay. Jedi Council is mostly the full-time employees that went down. So I was like, I can't sit at home and be sad. So I went on vacation to Costa Rica and caught up on stuff when I could. Because I was like, I'm just going to be sad, which is exactly what happened. Because I watched the trailer, or the teaser that we got to see, and I was sitting in the middle of the rainforest, like, crying into my phone. There was no other, like, Star Wars fans around me. I'm like, hey, no, okay. And then I was telling you guys right when I came in that I just watched, there's the Star Wars YouTube channel has a little clip that's kind of like a rundown of all the things that happened at Celebration. It doesn't go into a lot of detail, but just watching it, I got a little bit teary and choked up that all of this amazing stuff happened. And yeah, it's a bummer to not be there, but what I will say is, and I think it's so great, is that seeing all of these conventions kind of move forward in a way where it's like you do get to experience it differently if you're not there. Obviously, there's the energy. There's all the other people there when you're at Celebration. So I'm obviously that's the best way to do it if you can. But if you can't, you're not missing out on so, so much that you feel like everybody comes back and you're like, can you tell me anything? Because I didn't see anything.
Right. Well, Riley, what do you think being on the home front here?
Well, I like being on the home front. I like watching everything. I love the live streams that they're doing this. Mm. But you take the name, Celebrations. That tells you everything about the convention because I used to go every year when I was part of the Star Wars and 30 crew where we did the live show for the actual crowd of Celebrations, and that was always my favorite. And you're walking around and you are celebrating Star Wars. You're seeing people in cosplay, you're buying action figures, you're talking to like-minded fans. That's what's so fun. That's what I missed out. Not the panels, like aside from the 40th anniversary, I would have died to have been in there to hear John Williams play, to see Harrison Ford up in person. Those are the things that you cannot change that experience. But when you're at home, you're missing that celebration. You're missing being the Star Wars geek, talking with your friends, because that's who I am. I love Star Wars. I don't care what people think. I will yell and scream and love the trailer and then go and geek out with Ken and Christian and Tiffany. And whoever's around me, I will do that. And there's nothing better than when you're at a celebration. So, yeah, I miss being there. I miss being there.
Ken, so you were able to go. What did you think overall? Did they deliver? Because we all agreed last year that the everything as far as being there, like Perry said in London, was great. But as it seems on the home front here, did its job. It delivered on news. How do you feel being there? Did it deliver in celebration as a fan perspective, and did it deliver on a news cycle?
I think it absolutely exceeded any expectations once again. 2015, the celebration in Anaheim was one of my favorite memories as a fan, as a pundit in this realm of Star Wars media discussion. I didn't get a chance to go to London mostly because, number one, I don't have a passport. Two, that's a long flight. Right. But this absolutely exceeded. Congratulations to Disney, Lucasfilm, ReedPop, the people of Orlando who helped run this. It was so smooth. There was no problems. Yeah, there was a little bit of line issues here, partly because our wonderful fans came out in droves to support us, and some people couldn't get in, but we didn't expect that, Christian. It was a humble honor to see that many people come out for our panels, but everything went out great, and the balance between nostalgia, celebration, and news was perfect for me. I was happy that the news coming out of that was Star Wars itself and Carrie Fisher's tribute, and that they didn't announce an Obi-Wan. Not that I wouldn't have been excited, but let that be what it was, and let the Last Jedi panel be what it was. It was a great balance.
Well, I think it was a good space. It was a really good balance, and to continue off Ken was saying, as far as our panels go, I have to give a big thank you to the fans that were there for Jedi Council. We had like 600 people in the room. I know there were a ton of people that couldn't get in, and we met a lot of you at the meet and greet, so thank you very much for that. Obviously, the Star Wars Movie Trivia Schmodown that we did went over really well. Those are both on the channel. If you weren't there and you want to watch them, you should go ahead and do that. So I thank you very much for that. But, you know, there was just, in regards to like the Han Solo stuff and, you know, Obi-Wan, all those things, we're going to talk about it here in a little bit, but I think that they're holding off, and they're holding off a reason, because each day needs to be special, and each day needs to have something that you are talking about. Everybody was talking about John Williams and the tribute to Carrie Fisher and Harrison Ford and the jokes cracked on Harrison Ford from Warwick Davis and Hamill up there and Billy Dee Williams. Everybody was talking about that. And then you got to enjoy the floor, and there was other things that happened throughout it. On Friday, and we're sticking into film, so we'll cover really Thursday and Friday here. Friday was all about The Last Jedi. Everybody was talking about that trailer. Mm-hmm. There are tons of breakdowns about it, and that's what they needed to do. Yeah. I think that it would have been I think overload, if you start mentioning, because don't you want the focus to be on either Last Jedi or that opening panel, as opposed to, oh, we had this wonderful tribute to Carrie Fisher, but let's not talk about that. Let's talk about the announcement of Obi-Wan. I think that downplays it.
Well, and I think that because of what happened with Carrie this year, obviously, that's what they needed to do. I think if it were another year that hadn't happened, we might have gotten other film news. But I think that for every single fan, if they hadn't given her that time and given every fan that moment to really like kind of grieve and celebrate her together at Celebration, it would have been the wrong choice.
Right.
So looking at it that way, I think that they did the best thing that they possibly could do. And even going back to last year, everyone saying that there really wasn't that much that came out of London. And so making sure that every day did have something huge and things didn't get watered down, or people felt like after a day, it was like, what did we see today? Like,
right.
There was great
right.
stuff, but it all blended together.
I think it was a beautiful balance. I really do, because covering it here for Collider while you guys were doing an on-the-floor stuff, you're talking about the Battlefront 2 trailer at one point. Then you're talking about that beautiful tribute for Carrie Fisher. Then you're talking about the 40th anniversary and some of the people that came out, what people said. Then The Last Jedi and then Rebels. Those are some of the takeaways I got from watching from home. And that was such a nice balance to see, because it wasn't overwhelming. I think you touched on that. It wasn't watered down. Everybody was getting something. And I think also in regards to perhaps an Obi-Wan announcement, they're saving it for D23.
Well, that's what I think. And we're about to hit on that in a little bit here. But let's go to the next topic, Ken.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, Rian Johnson came out looking great in this whole celebration. And our friends at Star Wars News Net have collected some of the great stories and interviews that Rian Johnson was giving for ABC. He confirmed some things. He talked about, in his mind, The Last Jedi is singular, not plural.
And can people stop yelling at me now?
Sure.
When I said that,
probably
I like,
not.
I like
everyone's,
yelling. At
everyone's
you,
yelling at me. I says The Last Jedi is one person. No, you're crazy. It's all different Jedi.
he also said that Rey's parentage, or at least her background, will absolutely 100% be addressed in The Last Jedi. And this is, I mean, very forthcoming stuff, but also a little cheeky as well from Rian talking about what's at the end. Also in the same set of interviews, and Christian, we can decide when and where we want to talk about this story, you can combine it with the other one, but Mark Hamill saying anything's possible with Luke Skywalker in Episode 8. He and Daisy Ridley gave this Good Morning America interview where Hamill admitted some stuff about what he feels about this character.
Yeah, we're going to talk about Hamill in depth in a second here, but let's touch on Rian Johnson. And like you mentioned up top there, Ken, you got to give a lot of credit to this guy because he, not only were they giving him a lot of credit in that Last Jedi panel about what a tremendous writer he is and how much of a different take he's doing, but he's not just one of those guys that says, oh, I care about the fans, sure, and then here's you'll never see me, or I'm never going to take a picture with anybody. That dude was in line with everybody waiting for that Last Jedi panel. I think it was like something like 3 or 4 hours hanging out with the fans. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you how many fans I ran into that showed me the pass that he signed. That was a great move. He wanted to buy him pizza, but they weren't allowed to do it. That should be talked about. You don't hear stories like that often. I know J.J. Abrams 2 years ago bought everybody pizza. This was something even a little different, man. He was hanging out with the crowd, and I thought that was notable.
Even talked about in one of the interviews just saying the fact that he went out the night before and hung out with fans, and he was like, everyone was just like me. Like, their kids were dressed up. They were excited to talk about their first experience with Star Wars, and that he really wanted to be a part of the celebration as well, not just a director of one of the movies we're super excited about. And so it was cool because he kind of said experiencing that and seeing everybody and then being up there on that stage, it's like, we're all family. So he didn't have those nerves of like, oh my gosh, I hope I do them proud, because it's like, he's one of them. He's one of us.
Well, I think some of the stuff that he said now, if we talk about The Last Jedi, I think that it was also made pretty clear now after his comments that that's what the focus is in that trailer, is that what Luke wants to do is be the end of the Jedi. He is the Last Jedi. And there's some rumors going around that in that flashback of the burning temple, that he was the one that burnt it all down. I really hope that that's not true, but we'll see. But as far as it being singular, I mean, again, not a told you so, but I just always thought that made the most sense. The Rey's heritage stuff, I want to make sure that they remember that it's not, a lot of people, I've seen this report out there, oh, they say they're going to tell you who her parents are. He never says that.
No, he doesn't.
He never says that. What he says is that it will be addressed. Now, whether or not that is, you know, where she came from, maybe not that she's a clone, but whatever it is, other things of where she is, that will be tackled. So I don't think we're going to find out clear and cut who it is.
I mean, if you could even go to The Force Awakens and say her parentage was addressed.
Right. Well, it's true.
I was just going to say.
It just depends on how far he's going to go. That it's
certain
like,
point of view.
Yeah.
From a certain point of view, yes. Yeah. Maz addressed her parentage.
Yeah.
It was addressed in a force back. So he's not showing his cards.
I like that force back that you said. You meant flashback, right?
No, I mean force back.
Force back?
It's a flashback, but in the force.
I like that. Is that new?
No, people have been saying it for months.
You should take credit for it. You're honest.
I'm an honest guy.
Then he would have gotten all the tweets saying, you didn't make it up.
I told you. You stole it.
That's right.
I think that Rian Johnson, he's hiding his cards. He even says he's having fun because he said, oh, you almost got me to say something in this interview. Right. And I like that. And, you know, as we get going, there's more and more of this that address the parentage. Again, I think that it's less important for Ray's journey and more important to the fans. That's my take on it. I do hope we kind of get a confirmation that her parents are A and B or whatever. It might not be. I'm just trusting Rian. We'll get to some of the other comments that like Hamill and Daisy Ridley said, but Rian Johnson is doing something different. That's why they got him. If you watch Looper, you can tell we're going to get something different, and that's what I love about the guy. I'm so excited, and he's got something planned that's different, and everybody talked about it from Kathleen Kennedy all the way down the line to Mark Hamill and Daisy Ridley. So this is exciting stuff.
Ken.
Hey, you know, her question about, hey, who my parents are, what's my family, the answer from Luke might be, it doesn't matter.
Right. Exactly.
Just keep going forward.
Yeah.
That's not what it's about now. This is about what you're going to do. It's what, you know, is yet to come, which is what Maz tried to say to her, too. So, I absolutely do want it addressed in some kind of way. I don't want it to, you know, I don't think that's... We're not going to just forget about that. And as far as The Last Jedi being the title, I was kind of on that train, too. And you know what? It still could, from a certain point of view, mean Rey. Who knows? You know,
right.
And that's what was so good about the teaser trailer to me. I know a lot of people, I heard some blowback against it. That's silly. Stop that. It was a great trailer. And because it's a teaser. It's a teaser. And I don't know if Luke's saying it's time for the Jedi to end mid-afternoon naps. We're going to change training methods. I don't know. Doesn't matter to me. I'm so excited to go on this ride. And Rian Johnson, who we got to fly out with, really. We got to pass by and just kind of look
at
him. Yeah, yeah. Oh, that's right. You were on a different flight.
I was on with Ray Park.
That's pretty good, too. Rian Johnson seems like a fan, too. He has that camera out, even on the panel. He's taking the pictures, capturing things from a Star Wars fan point of view, and I love it. I think he, like you said, up top, really came out looking good in this whole celebration.
All right, let's talk about Grouchy Luke.
Grouchy Luke is an interesting thing. There's a couple different stories around. I'm looking at the one on The Guardian where, you know, Luke's like, it's in this interview now, and it's in this article. Luke says, I told director Rian Johnson, I fundamentally disagree with virtually everything you've decided about my character. He also has expressed some stuff about Episode 7 where he liked, it's kind of cheeky the way he's saying it, like, I liked everyone's character but mine. He also said in some moments in the celebration panels and various interviews that he thought, you know, when that lightsaber was moving in the snow in 7, it should have been him grabbing it, and that there was missed opportunities with him and Harrison and even Carrie not being on screen together again, which is one I actually really believe in, and that also he should have been present at Han Solo's death. He's being a little salty, Christian. Is it fun? Is it misdirection? What is it?
I think it's a little of everything. I mean, there's like a mixture of all the stuff that he said over the last year and a half or so, and he seems to not agree with a lot of the stuff that's been done so far. To his credit, also, he said that he didn't like the fact that all he does is take the hood down and then it ends. He's like, how's that going to play? And then he said, well, I didn't take into consideration John Williams' music. I didn't take into consideration the way that it was going to, like, the legitimate, you know, literal cliffhanger that was there. And he said it worked. There's two arguments to be made with the Han Solo thing, because I think that there is something, there was a missed opportunity to have them all together, obviously the big three together, and we're never ever going to get that. However, I also think that this is life. This is, whether it's in a galaxy far, far away, the fact that Luke didn't get it. Luke, I think it adds to the demons. Mm-hmm. Luke went off to go to this planet to find himself, and in doing that, he wasn't there for his friend. I think that there's something kind of poetic about that. I think there's something, you know, that you're not always going to be there when you want to be there. Even as powerful as Luke, you couldn't be there. So I don't mind that he wasn't there. I actually think that I'm okay with it. I do think that it would have gotten, and we talked about this, there would have been a lot of chills in that theater had that lightsaber gone to Luke. But once again, I don't think it's fitting the narrative that they've set. Now, here's the one thing I will say, and I love Mark Hamill more than anything. He's one of the most beloved people of all time. I'm going to trust Rian Johnson's writing over Mark Hamill's. So I've just over past experience, things that I've seen. I just think that if Rian Johnson wants to go with a different version of Luke, we also don't want to run into the same thing. What was the biggest problem people had with The Force Awakens?
It's just that other movies redone, Christian.
Mm-hmm. Valid points to a lot of people, though, too. I didn't mind it because I think it reintroduced what we're doing with Star Wars. But Episode 8 needs to be different. It needs to kick you in the ass and go, well, that's a different type of Star Wars. So if that's the case, I'm okay with it. How do you feel about it?
Well, that's you bring up the point. I could argue, and there are valid points, that remake of A New Hope, gently letting the audience back into the nostalgia that was the original trilogy. This is the aesthetic we're going for. But not including Luke is such a bold storytelling point. That's what I came out. I wanted to see him grab the lightsaber. I wanted to see the big three together, but you said it. That is a story that now is carrying us into the next movie and will probably continue to carry us through Episode 9. It was so important. That's what they set out, the architects of this new universe, with Kathleen Kennedy, J.J. Abrams, Lawrence Kasdan, and then Rian Johnson and Colin Trevorrow. So it made sense to me. Am I sad about it? Yeah, the fan in me is like, man, we'll never see that. But that's okay. And then to your point of Rian Johnson kicking us in the butt with Episode 8, I said it before, that's why they got him. And I've heard there's so many rumors out there too that he's doing something, really, really different. And then if you could take Mark Hamill's comments that he fundamentally disagrees with everything Rian Johnson is doing, well, then he might be doing something right. If he's getting a reaction from the Jedi Master Luke Skywalker, he might be doing something that's uncomfortable and is different. And so that I want to see. Whether it will stick the landing, we'll have to wait until December 15th.
Well, I think that's the part that stands out the most to me about hearing everyone talk about Rian and his take and what he's doing with the movie is that even when Rogue One was coming out, people were like, it's different. But then there was quickly the, it's not dark, it's not too dark, like the everyone trying to course correct.
Right.
In this case, every single person involved with Star Wars is like, this is a different take. This is a different take. We really trust him. We're excited about it. This is a different take. So I think that that's something where it's like, it makes me more excited because I don't know what we're going to get. But if you look at the original trilogy, the second one is different than the original as well. So it's like you want something different. Every trilogy, you need the middle one to shake things up a bit. Otherwise, it's just like smooth sailing, and the Force Awakens stuff happened in it. But it's like looking at this one and being excited about that and hearing what Mark says, it actually was really interesting to me because I didn't expect to hear this sort of stuff from him. And I do think that because of what Rian has said about being a fan, I'm sure that he took to heart some of the stuff that Mark was saying to him. And if he chose to ignore it, then you better believe it was for good reason. Because I know as a fan, if you're sitting there and you're like, so I wrote this about your character, and he's like, I hate it all, it's nothing that I agree with at all, that you're going to be like, oh my God, either I need to change stuff or I feel so strongly about these decisions that I'm going to stick with it.
Or you sit back and you realize that you're talking to someone that has been so close to a character that has made this person's career that you're talking to. So there's, and if you ever watched that Dinner for Five that Kevin Smith, J.J. Abrams, Mark Hamill, I think it was Jason Lee, I forget who I said, but there's a bunch of people that were sitting down talking about it, and Hamill talked about what his thoughts were going to be. And I think that in this interview, he's talking about the dark side thing. Mm-hmm. Hamill suggested, I think that that Luke goes to the dark side, I think, in that interview.
Yeah,
I think he does, right?
Yeah.
That's why I don't think it's going to happen. I didn't think it was going to happen anyway. But now, because fundamentally, if that was the direction he was going, then Mark Hamill had already been there. So I'm wondering what this means. I think that it basically means that he's just abandoning the Jedi Order and that maybe he doesn't think Luke would do that. But what do you take from all this, Ken?
I'm excited by this. I'm excited that it's maybe uncomfortable for us as Star Wars fans. I'm excited that Hamill's got an opinion on his character. He's always had that. Remember, he felt going into Jedi, Luke should have like a big like bone earring and be ripped and scarred and have gone through this weird journey between Empire and Jedi. And Luke George was like, I got an idea.
No, put so, black on.
Yeah, just wear black. So I'm excited by all this. This should be different. This should challenge us. That's what we've kind of been hoping. that we are going to get from Ryan Johnson. That's right. What we think they picked him for, and it's all good to me, man. Let's see where we can go.
And there's a whole team behind him. It's not like certain instances where another director was like, this is what I want to do, and everyone was saying yes. This one, I'm sure that Ryan has come up against people that are like, okay, no. I mean, I don't think Kathleen Kennedy is sitting around being like, do whatever you want. We totally trust you.
No, and Kathleen Kennedy cut Mark Hamill off at one point, too, because Mark Hamill was saying, I think, that, well, you know, the first couple stories were about Luke, but this isn't really, it's not about him, though. It's more about the other guys. And the way he was kind of saying it was like, yeah, you know, I had my time. And then Kathleen said, let me jump in there. He is very, very important to the story in this next movie.
Well, there's also something, a bit of humility in Rian Johnson, and I don't know where this conversation took place, if it was in these interviews or not, but Mark Hamill saying, I'm really afraid to come back and do this Luke because of everything we've set up from the original trilogy, and Rian Johnson leans forward and goes, me too. So that, there's, and Mark Hamill goes, God, I like this guy. Right. You know, the theme from my comments are, they're taking a chance here. And if you're a little queasy, you're a little afraid, you got butterflies in your stomach to do this, then you might be onto something.
Yeah. All right, what's next, Ken?
Hey, you know, Star Wars is behind that big charity drive, the Force for Change, and as part of that, you might win a chance to walk the Han Solo set with Warwick Davis. And a promo video came out, and it was cool, it's funny. Warwick is amazingly charming. I love him. But this alien was revealed. Our first look at a new alien in the Han Solo movie. It's very similar to the Grand Species, which is most notably Ri-Yes, or Ri-Yes, however you want to say it, from Return of the Jedi. He was on Jabba's sail barge. Right. He was the three-eyed creature alien that actually took care of Jabba's frog pet. It's our first look. Something kind of exotic, different. Almost Pan's Labyrinth-like, Christian. What do you think here?
Pan's Labyrinth is a great reference, too. And a second time, I think, Pan's Labyrinth reference has been made today. Yeah. There was something also interesting that fans have been chirping about here. The character's name, something Voss. And people are going, well, does that mean Quinlan Voss is going to be in? No, it doesn't mean that at all. I mean, it just happens to have, because this is an alien species, and Quinlan Voss was not of that race at all. You can see Quinlan Voss in The Phantom Menace. But I would love if Quinlan Voss was in another movie, but that's another conversation at another time. Very cool to see another alien race. Now, apparently this character has a bigger role. I think that's cool. I think that Han Solo should be interacting with more alien races, learning more, because he's been on so many different adventures. So I love it. Ken, what do you think?
Yeah, I love it too. I mean, wow, new alien Star Wars. I didn't think that was going to happen. So this is a big reveal. But it looks good. It looks great. You know, sometimes when I see these photos, I think of George Lucas looking at it going, yep, that's what I wanted to do with the cantina. Yeah. And I think Han Solo's going to go to some fun, exotic places, Mark.
Well, that's obviously Snoke. I mean, come on. I mean, let's connect the dots in a logical and rational way. It is Snoke, and Phil Lord and Chris Miller are tipping their hat to it. It's great. It's fine. I love the way it looks. I love the way that they put in even a little effects work where they blinks and the directors are saying, no. Like, one director is like, I forget
Chris,
who, it was like,
Chris was like, no.
And then the other one's like, no, I want to show them. This is cool. That, to me, is they're having fun, and you need that for a spin-off movie like a Han Solo movie.
Your Snoke theory sucks.
He also just looks like so badass. Like, I feel like it almost reminds me of, like, I don't know, like Statham or something. Or like Tom Hardy, that he's just like rugged and he's going to wreck stuff. And just from the way he's sitting and the curl of his lip and stuff. So it made me really excited to kind of see what this character is going to bring into the mix.
Well, they said that he's going to be a pretty prominent character. Let's see what happens. Ken, what's next?
Hey, Kathleen Kennedy did some speaking at the convention.
What? You didn't even talk about the Warwick thing.
Oh, yeah. Hey, it turns out Warwick might be in the Han Solo movie. Anyways, Kathleen Kennedy.
Well, Warwick Davis, what? I mean, I think that, well, you know he's going to be in Rebels. Yeah, season
as
4. He's going to be in season 4. He's getting more involved in these movies. I think that, I mean, he's popped up in 1, 2,
He's been in
one,
the most
two,
Star Wars movies, I think, outside of Anthony Daniels.
Because he was in 1, 2, and 3, right? He was in episode 6, obviously. I don't know if he was in Rogue One.
Yeah, he was in Rogue One.
He was?
Yeah, he was in Rogue One. Yeah.
Well, then this is a non-story. Because, I mean, he was in Force Awakens
he's
also.
He's a good luck charm.
He's a good luck charm. So, I mean, and he's one of the most charming dudes ever.
He's great.
Him? And Josh Gad. By the way, we didn't mention Josh Gad.
Oh, yeah.
Phenomenal.
In that Last Jedi panel. And I said this before one of our videos. Josh Gad, who I'm like iffy on with some of his performances. You get something like LeFou, he was amazing in, and Olaf, he's great. And there's some performances of his, I just find him a little irritating. Not the case here. He was one of the best moderators I've seen at any convention, not just Star Wars. Make sure you get Josh Gad to do something again, because that dude was, I mean, great. That was an amazing performance. Okay, so let's get into this actual category here. Category?
Category. Sure. Kathleen Kennedy here. She, you know, one of the big things we thought maybe that we might get from this Star Wars celebration was a new announcement on a standalone movie, Obi-Wan. But we didn't get it. But she says, well, speaking with MTV News' Josh Horowitz, I think we're getting close. My hope would be sometime around the summer. I never want to predict the creative process because it's its own thing. So we're in the midst of those discussions right now. There's some other things we can come back to in the story, Christian. But D23?
Yes.
San Diego?
No.
What do we got?
D23. It makes all the sense in the world. I mean, this is another thing that we have been saying right before Star Wars happened. It didn't make sense to do it at Celebration. They had the stuff that they wanted to release there, and they did it. Now they really want to make a push on Star Wars at D23, and they want to make D23 pop even more. Like 2 years ago,
when The Force Awakens was there.
It was, but they didn't even do Force Awakens as much as they talked. Like when they did D23, it wasn't, what the hell? It was more about the parks.
Yeah, I don't think they did the stage, but the cast was there because I interviewed them.
The cast was there, but there was, and that's when you, is that when you asked
Darth Plagueis?
Yeah. So there was really nothing to give you from Star Wars. Now, Civil War showed some stuff that was just for the D23, but it got the buzz going. It was Jungle Book that stole D23. Right. Now, I think what they're going to do is they're going to hit hard with Star Wars this year, and I think they're going to give you the Han Solo title, whatever that might be. You're going to get, I think, two announcements. I think you're getting two announcements for standalone movies. I think you're going to get the Obi-Wan movie, and I think you're going to get the Bounty Hunter movie.
Well, I also think it's they're filming right now, right? Han Solo?
Filming Han
currently.
Solo, yeah.
So it's like, the fact that you couldn't even have the directors or a lot more of the people from that film at Celebration, I feel like D23 is the perfect time to have them all show up and be able to talk more and hype everybody up even more about Han Solo.
Riley, what do you think? You think, is it D23 or is it Comic-Con, or is it maybe is it May the 4th?
It's not Comic-Con. I think it's likely at D23. I think they want to make that an event for fans and for people that could come and see it. So I do believe it's an announcement for Obi-Wan and the Bounty Hunters.
Do you think the same thing?
I do. Yeah. However, I wouldn't be surprised if just out of left field we get an announcement.
Yeah.
They've done that a couple times.
Yeah,
that's
what I'm saying. Like May the 4th.
Yeah, May the 4th could be up there. But, you know, the money's on D24 or D23.
Yeah,
D24. You know, the sequel to D23.
Put your money on D24.
Have we heard if Marvel's going to do Comic-Con this year?
They are doing Comic-Con.
Okay.
It just announced.
So that's the part that I feel like is kind of interesting, because I'm curious to see what Disney decides to do, whether it's focus that D23 is Star Wars and Comic-Con stays with Marvel.
There it is.
Because that would make sense.
I think there's going to be a presence at both, you know, but for Marvel, it makes so much sense to just kind of keep it in that
genre.
It's Comic-Con.
Yeah.
That's as simple as that.
That makes a lot of sense now. That opens up. I think it makes more sense. I think even a bigger push on Star Wars, because we've said this point, but we should say it again. Han Solo comes out in just about a year. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's really not that far away. It's a year away. I don't think they're changing it. They're not going to move it to December, I think, in about a year. So it would make sense in, you know, with 10 months out by the time we get to D23, a little teaser, still photos from the set, some more information about standalone movies. I think it's like a little mini, it's like a continuation of what they did at Celebration. Ken, are we totally off here? Do you think they're going to do anything at D23?
No, I think D23 is going to be very big. I think, you know, I think they're trying to take a cut at San Diego Comic-Con. I think that's the reason they've got it so close.
But are they now with Marvel, though? Because maybe this was let's put a Band-Aid
ball
on the Marvel.
Maybe you're playing ball. It's not that studios don't need San Diego Comic-Con, but we've seen over the last couple of years the emphasis on San Diego is not as big as it used to be.
Sure.
And Disney loves to win. Disney loves to own things. They love to. We were driving through Orlando, and our boss is like, by the way, this is a Disney city.
Mm-hmm.
What? This whole city is Disney.
Right.
So I think they're having not fun, but a high business level. They're like, let's do something big at D23, and that would be it.
Yeah.
That would be it. Other part of the story, Christian, there's a couple little things here, but Horowitz also got Kennedy to address the Han Solo's name origin theory. And
to which Ellis was so happy to hear.
Yeah, you know, and Kathleen Kennedy was like, I'm not a sure that's entirely what Bob meant. Crazy old Bob Iger. There's more to Han Solo's name, but it's not just, it's not that it's not his name. It's obviously his name. It will always be his name. So we got it right there. And, you know, much like Ellis and all of you out there, just calm down, take a breath. It was like with Sana Solo showing up in the Marvel comic. Just turn the page, wait for the next issue, see what they're going to do. They respect and love Star Wars just as much
as we fans. It's basically like, you and I are both Yankee fans. It's like Derek Jeter made his name.
Jeter?
What's
his name? Derek Jeter. You ever watch that Derek Jeter number two?
Can't wait for that movie.
Oh, man, that number two is something. But Derek Jeter made his name by winning a lot of championships, by being the captain of the Yankees. That's what they mean. It's like, how did he get his name of being the best smuggler in the galaxy?
Right.
So, all right, now it's time to move on to the next category. Which category? I keep saying category.
What's going on today?
Category. I'm jumping into the schmodown. I'm getting ready for this championship match.
Can I spin the wheel, see what category I get?
Seriously. Sorry. The next topic, which we're going into the world of what we simply call here, what's the deal with canon? And that was so much fun at the panel, by the way.
Did everyone do it with you?
600 people screamed that. It was amazing. We have a lot of stuff that happened that dropped at Celebration and other news, too. Ken, what's the first story in the world?
The first thing we're going to start off with, this was revealed, confirmed, I should say. We'd kind of thought this, predicted this, speculated on this. But season 4 of Star Wars Rebels, as announced by Dave Filoni, will be the last.
I love this news.
Yeah, we kind of thought this was coming.
I want to talk to Tiff first because we didn't get the chance to talk to Tiffany about it. I happen to love this news, and I'll explain why in a second. How do you feel about it?
It bums me out just because I like the show so much, but I also really appreciate the fact that it's not let's just keep this going until there's nothing left to tell. I appreciate that it feels like we've got a story, we've told it, we're going to move on to the next thing. It's going to be, I feel like it gives us more of a great ending that I think is going to be what all the fans really want. Because there's so many shows where it's like they just keep going on and you're like, you should have ended it early. You should have ended it like a couple seasons ago. So I think the fact that they've talked about it, they know what they want to do with the show, they know what they wanted to do with the show, where they wanted to take it to, and that we're going to get other stuff with other characters, see more of maybe Hera down the line.
Yep.
That I think initially as a fan, I'm like, oh, but I've like become so connected with all those characters. Of course I want to see more, but the other side is that I get it.
I agree with you 100%. I think that, of course, that there's something it's going to be sad to watch these characters go that you have become attached to. And I don't think we give enough credit to this show to where, remember, these were brand new characters that we were only introduced to 3 years ago, and they are beloved.
Remember how crazy it was at Celebration? Like the first time that
it was Comic-Con.
Oh, at Comic-Con. When the cast was there, and it was like, I don't even think they showed the episodes there. No one had really seen anything.
So they first announced everything about it. They were promoting it at Comic-Con, and then
and
the
panel was
right.
like so packed, and everyone was so excited about it. And I remember even hearing the cast be like, this is crazy.
Well, because the Clone Wars also. Yeah. Clone Wars had such a following from the Star Wars fan base that there was a lot on their shoulders. Yeah. And they've done it, and they've picked up this lore from what they were able to accomplish in Rebels. But it was the best move to do this for exactly what you were saying. It's you don't want to keep on going to where you don't have any story to tell. And then Dave Filoni said it in the panel. He's been on a show that just ended abruptly and he couldn't finish telling his story. Why risk that again? Why because of the other thing is timeline wise, you're pushing it. Season 3 was a year before the events of Rogue One. Now they get to fill in that year. This whole season that we're about to see, you get to fill that year up into Rogue One. I love the announcement of it. I think it makes a lot of sense. I'll be sad to watch it go, but I'll also be very happy to watch the brand new animated series come in, which they're going to announce maybe at D23. Ken?
Yeah, I agree with everything you guys are saying here, too. I can echo that. I'm glad that Filoni's getting the chance to end his own story on his own. He definitely got burned with Clone Wars. And Rebels has grown into this powerful show for a lot of different people. You walk around Celebration, and the amount of Heras and the amount of Sabines. Sabine's probably one of the more cosplay characters out there. She's become very important and very popular to a lot of fans. And that shows they've done a good job. And this show, the legacy will last forever and ever and ever. And I'm glad the story will come to a nice finite point.
Riley, you're a big Rebels fan, so what do you think?
No, you leave them wanting more.
Yeah.
I think you go out, because you've all said it, I'll touch on it too, when you're spinning and trying to just kind of tread water to get to a certain story point that we're all ready for, which is now Rogue One, you know, and the battle over Scarif, I think that it can get stale, it can get boring, but they know what they're doing, they know where they want to end, and that's important for the characters. It's like a long form movie,
yeah.
And we're gonna get a beginning, a middle, and end. And I couldn't agree more with it, because then we get something new, which you touched on. We get a new animated series. That's what I want. I'm excited to keep getting new properties, all new characters that we can fall in love with and have more Sabines mm-hmm. walking around cosplaying, more Ezras, more everything.
Well, even the shorts that we're getting.
Well, yeah, we're going to talk about that for sure. But you know what? What I also think that after hearing Dave Filoni talk about this and after seeing that trailer and hearing that they're going to go a little darker, they're going to be able to do what they did in Clone Wars, is what it seemed like. I'm predicting two survivors in this thing for the whole show, and that two of the possible three. The two, definite, we know, Hera and Chopper. And those are the easy predictions, because we know that everyone else, I think, is going to be gone, with the exception of Ezra, if it turns out that he indeed is someone that we're going to see down the line. If Ezra survives, then you're going to see a lot, because when this season ends, Last Jedi will already be out in the theater. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I think it'll be it would be so interesting if they did it this way. Let's just throw it out there and say that Ezra is Benicio del Toro, right?
Yeah.
Let's just throw that out there and say that, and if it happens, they could do something so interesting to where when that is revealed, they can be, let's say it's revealed when the movie comes out. Now, when would they reveal it in the show? Would they reveal that in the show, like that's kind of the dark side right beforehand? Or, oh no, we know that that's him.
Yeah.
And then how does it lead? You know what I mean? Like, it'd be interesting. Or it's just a silly theory that we had fun with.
Yeah, I think, I don't believe that we'll ever see an animated character. I mean, I know we had Saw.
Yeah.
No. But
and we heard their names.
Something like mm-hmm. that.
You don't think we're going to see Hera?
Smaller Easter eggs. Smaller, like Ezra becoming a major character in The Last Jedi, I want more than anything. I think it's the same reason I want Darth Plagueis to be Snoke. I like the connective mm-hmm. tissue to the prequels, and I would love to see it Last Jedi with a connection to Rebels. I just think it's going to be relegated to, there's Chopper in the background for Rogue One. We hear Hera over the loudspeaker. The things like that, I think, is more along the lines of what they're doing. I would love to be proved wrong.
Right. All right, Ken, what's next?
Speaking of Dave Filoni, who is great, by the way. He was great in all these panels. Anything he was on, he's funny, he's entertaining, kind of looks like the guy you want to get a drink with, which I apologize, Dave, for drunkenly costing you a couple years ago at San Diego Comic-Con.
Nice.
Don't remind him.
But yeah, we talking about, we got Forces of Destiny coming out. It's
Yay!
This new shorts thing of focusing, at least in its initial run, on a lot of the strong female characters in the Star Wars universe, and Dave Filoni kind of revealed that one of those will be Hera.
It was a goof, right?
It was kind of a goof. It seemed like a goof. I was watching that panel. I think it was the heroines of Star Wars. Amy Ratcliffe did a great job moderating it, and Dave just kind of was like, yeah, you know, Hera. Maybe I should have said that. It looks as though that Hera is going to survive well into the events of Return of the Jedi and may actually have a little mission or a little adventure, a little story with Han and Leia on Endor during the time of Return of the Jedi. Canon questions here, Christian.
I love a lot of them. I love it. I think that it's cool, and I think that she's the one character that that should survive, because if you look, she is really the architect of the rebellion from New Dawn. If you mm-hmm. look, I mean, you know, you could also make arguments that her dad was the major influence and person mm-hmm. to kind of start the idealism of starting this rebellion. But for what she did, I think that she's a very important character, an underrated character, brilliantly voiced by Vanessa Marshall, by the way. And I think that we are going to see more of her, obviously, and we should see more of her. And I actually am going to disagree with Riley. I think that the one person that I think that could make a crossover into these movies could be someone like Hera. I think Hera could be an interesting character to bring into the feature films, because we don't know when they're going to land. I think it'd be a ballsy move in general for them to do a movie that doesn't rely on some of the main characters in between the time of episode 4 and 5. Because that hasn't even really been talked about. And we could see kind of stuff that's been going on. And I think that you can introduce newer characters and characters like a Hera, because I think a lot of times people are worried about how small the universe is sometimes where you're doing Obi-Wan movies and the Han Solo movies, and maybe if you start to branch out a little bit and stick in familiar characters like this, it will work. But as far as this Forces of Destiny thing goes, I think this is a really smart move, the way they're kind of interweaving characters that we knew. And then in general, Tiffany, what are your thoughts on the Forces of Destiny?
I think it's awesome. I wonder if this was already like really far in the works before everything that happened with Carrie, or if it was something where it's like, we really want to push this, because it is something that, you know, even just in geek culture in general, where it's like having Wonder Woman coming out and then having the focus on saying there are these really strong female characters that I think people in some ways overlooked that have been in the Star Wars universe from the beginning. So having a series like this come out, and I think they're also doing either mini books or something to go along with the shorts as well. So I think that's a really cool thing where it's, you know, when you talk about the problems of canon and crossover and mixing things up, if these are just little tiny short snippets of stories, I don't know if it's a continuous story. They can fall in anywhere and you're highlighting these different characters. To me, that's awesome. And I think that also it's, obviously, they were building Leia up to be an even more strong political character that, you know, is at the forefront of everything. And now that we know that she's not going to be in the next episode, Hera would be someone.
We don't know Leia's not going to be.
I thought they said she was not.
Carrie Fisher's not going to be.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good correction.
Yeah.
But I feel like that's something where maybe Hera kind of starts they can kind of start pushing her forward even more as a character to be the leader.
Sure. Okay. Well, let's. Anybody else have thoughts on this? I know you're a big Force of Destiny.
I'm excited about it. I'm looking at they're on this article here. I'm looking on Star Wars News Net. They got the picture of Leia on Endor, because I know there's Leia on Hoth is one of the episodes. And that's one of the figures that's been created. But you know, it looks like her and Wicket are trying to get to Brighttree Village, and they're running into some stormtroopers and some little crazy adventures.
That's kind of cool.
I like that.
Yeah,
I like that.
Did we also talk about Dave Filoni changing his shirt?
Oh, no, that's coming
up.
That's coming up.
Well, you see, we send notes out before the show goes.
But in fact, during that panel, I get really excited. I just want to talk about stuff again.
What's next, Ken? Hey, did you know Dave Filoni changed his shirt during the Rebels panel? That's right. Ahsoka Lives! Changed to Ahsoka Lives! And he addressed it also in the press conference we got to go to.
First question asked.
Yeah, and he seemed, it seemed like he was, he loves playing with everybody, even his own cast. He loves having some fun. So yeah, what do you think? Subtle hint. I certainly have a theory. Christian, what do you have?
I think it's still interesting. It's like, I don't think she's going to be Force Ghost, because they're pushing the fact that she even says it in season two, I am no Jedi. So I don't think that she is going to be a Force Ghost, and I think it becomes a little too tricky down the line if she is one. I think she's alive. I think she's going to show up. I think once and for all, she's toast. I also think that something that is relevant.
Wait, you think he's going to bring her back just to kill her?
Because of this. Because
she's toast.
There's also relevance to the question I asked at the press conference. And I said to Dave Filoni, I was like, you definitively said that Darth Vader and Palpatine would not be in season three because you wanted to have the focus on Thrawn. Can you definitively say that Palpatine and Vader are not in season four? And he said, no, I can't definitively say that. So I think that the Vader and Ahsoka thing comes to an end. I think it's part two, and I think this time Vader, that hatred is going out. This is the end of it. Or, you know, you don't have to have Vader take her out, because they kind of already did that already. Filoni is a guy that might not want to revisit the same thing. But I think that Ahsoka, she kind of has to be gone. So if they are going to bring her alive, she is ultimately going to die again. What do you think?
I still kind of think, I remember watching the episode and feeling like it was going to be a kind of Lord of the Rings, Gandalf, Return of Gandalf the White.
Right.
And I know there have been some references about her coming back as the wolf. And that to me seems like the most logical, easy thing, where it's like, she's back, but she could only, in that case, it could be something where it's like, she's only back for a time, where it's like Gandalf comes back. And I even think at one of the panels we went to, Filoni said that he was a big Lord of the Rings fan and said something about Gandalf or that reference. And so to me, that seems like the easiest thing, because it's like, you don't want to bring. They already had that big battle with Vader. If she goes back again and it's like battle again, and now she really dies.
You don't necessarily have to have that, but you know, are we approaching Game of Thrones stuff here? And it's like
Worgen. Yeah, I think I absolutely think this is all related. I think that Convor, which is those little force birdies that fly around her, and I think if you go to the Mortis episode and what the daughter does, and the daughter morphs into little
birds.
You
know what? You're making sense.
Yeah, I think that's what it's at. And it's a little weird. It's a little different. It's a little bit of, you know, Young Guns taking some peyote in the desert, looking at the size of that chicken, but I'm okay with
it. Does it hurt the, not hurt the lore, but does that make you scratch your head with the lore?
A little bit. Sometimes I always say when Star Wars gets too sci-fi, which is weird to say because it's in space, it's really a fantasy epic, and you know, that's, I guess I'm correcting myself, maybe that's more on the fantasy side. Time, like, I don't want time travel in Star Wars. That's a little bit too weird sci-fi for me. To me, it's about the wars, it's about the characters, it's about the action. This is a little different, but you know what, the Mortis stuff is tremendously different.
True.
Came from the mind of George Lucas himself, along with Filoni, and that's some of my favorite stuff.
You okay with Ahsoka being the wolf, if she is indeed the wolf?
I'd be okay with that, absolutely. Yeah. I just second everything Ken said. Mm-hmm.
Would you say you're hungry like the wolf for
I'm
my
I'm hungry
ideas?
Like the wolf. I like all this. Look, what I really want from Ahsoka is a standalone movie with her. I don't know if I'll ever get it. I think that her character especially would be fascinating to see in live action and surprise the hell out of fans. Do you think we'll ever see something like that? I know I'm kind of going back
on movie?
What you just said a minute ago.
Yeah, but I'm talking about like a movie where this character shows up from Rebels in The Last Jedi. I'm talking about a standalone that could be Ahsoka.
It's certainly possible. I thought about this the other day to where, like, look, who's the most popular character in Legends history?
Thrawn.
Yeah.
And Thrawn showed up in this season, this new
Rebels.
New version of canon, and he's in Rebels now, but like, and it's not his own movie, but he was a popular enough character. I still think that Sloane should show, not our own movie, but I think Sloane should show up. Mm-hmm. But I think that what's going to happen here eventually is there will be a character introduced, whether or not it's in Rebels or the new animated show or in a book, that the fans just say, we want that character now. It's like, you know, in wrestling terms, The Rock shows up on a scene or Stone Cold shows up on the scene and becomes this big character and you want more and more and more and more of them. If that kind of character is developed and the fans really, really want it, it's certainly possible because there's no end date to when we're getting Star Wars material.
But don't you already think that that's Ahsoka? Like, the fact that like people come out in droves and did the Ahsoka Lives thing, like,
I don't know if
at
she can open
a celebration, and I mean,
I don't think it's crazy. Yeah. I don't know if she can open a movie yet, and I don't know what the movie is because I think that with this book that we got of her, and if she, especially she's running around, you know, peeing on trees now, then I don't know.
You're crazy that she can't open a movie. Are you kidding me? We have Rogue One, where the brand new characters, and it's just Star Wars, and that thing blows up.
No. But what's the movie though? The movie is the Death Star. They're playing off of Episode 4.
Granted, you take the Ahsoka character and you put her in a time frame that we are reminiscent of.
That we haven't seen.
Could be between, depending on how they set up Ahsoka, if they do this. Is it between Empire and Jedi? Is it between New Hope and Empire?
But we're talking about her possibly being a wolf. So we're going to see her running around the forest during that time.
You got to set up the mythology. We're going to maybe do it with Rebel Season 4. I think, though, if you say, here's a movie set between A and B, and Ahsoka's one of the main characters with some other characters, I think Star Wars is going to open no matter what.
Ahsoka, if the one time that we were going to visit the Clone Wars again, if we were going to revisit the Clone Wars with a different director, and you told me you were doing an Ahsoka movie in the Clone Wars era,
there you go.
It's risky, but I still don't know if it necessarily opens too big, but I still think that, I mean, well, it's Star Wars. It's going to open big.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is I don't know if people, I don't know if you're the Lucasfilm execs and all of these potential movies are being pitched, if you push some of them to the side and say, well, let's take the shot on Ahsoka. I don't know.
Yeah.
All right, Ken, what's next?
Hey, a lot of new books were announced at Star Wars Celebration. That includes comic books, young adult novels, kids' books, and, of course, some of the novels that we love to read, Christian. Nothing that I would say was too surprising. There's a lot out there. A Phasma novel. We're going to get that for sure. We know that we're going to I'm trying to scroll through these nice pictures here. We've got The Inferno Squad, Battlefront 2, Christy Golden, which ties directly into Battlefront 2. The game, of course, Inferno Squadron got a big pop and was mentioned in that Battlefront 2 panel with the character that's in the single-player story.
Yep.
So there's that. Then there's a Phasma comic, which will explain how she got maybe out of that trash capacity. actor mm-hmm. and off Starkiller Base. And my favorite one, it was very quiet to me, was we got from, this is maybe not from Del Rey, you're saying for me?
The Leia one.
The Leia one, the young Leia Lucasfilm written publishing. By Claudia Gray. Yeah. And then the Legend of Luke Skywalker, and then also going back to Del Rey, I'm looking forward to A Certain Point of View, which is the anthology set in The New Hope with characters. And my friend Madeline Rue, who's an author, is one of the authors for the short story. She was telling me a little bit about it, stuff I can't share yet, and it's got me really excited.
And I won't say either, but from what you were talking about, it sounds phenomenal. But what I will say, hi, nice head. What I will say is that this was the part of Celebration that I was disappointed with. Not the announcements of the actual books, because the Phasma book, the Inferno Squad, the Certain Point of View, the Leia stuff, all stuff that I want to read and I want to read tomorrow. But a lot of these were already announced.
Yeah.
A lot of them already, like, I knew all this stuff too. I thought there was going to be new stuff. I think what they should have done is hold it and not send anything. Like, they announced Inferno Squad, and I guess I understand what they were going for. They wanted to announce Christy Golden's new book, and then they were going to go, oh, and by the way, Inferno Squad's actually Battlefront 2, and Battlefront 2, the story is canon. Mm-hmm. All that stuff is great. I just think that they missed how they represented it, how they announced it. I would have much rather them said, and Christy Golden, who totally understands Star Wars, and that I think Dark Disciples, one of your favorites.
Yep.
Her writing this and hearing what this story is going to be about the point of view of the Empire, which they've been doing a lot of that recently, and now having this kind of combined into Battlefront, is great stuff. The fact that I'm interested also why, I mean, I know that Claudia Gray really made her name in the Star Wars community with Lost Stars, mm-hmm. with Lucasfilm Publishing. So now she's going back to Lucasfilm Publishing with this Leia. With Leia, and what a great opportunity to be able to do that. So I get that, but I also think it's strange that after she just crushed it with Bloodline. It might just been a part of her deal to where she had to come back to Lucasfilm to do it, and what a way to do it. So, but it's this 40, it's the 40 stories celebrating 40 years of Star Wars. We're going to have a lot of great authors in there. I think. Mm-hmm. Do we know a lot of the authors that are in there? For sure?
We do. A lot of them are familiar. I think Paulus Kemp's in there. Chuck Wendig. I think Claudia Gray as well.
Okay.
And a long list of others. I mean, you know, we're talking over close to 40 authors there.
Right. So I mean, so that stuff. Everything that's coming out, I thought was great. It was just, I think that it didn't have the impact. A lot of people were like, well, what's happening? What's going on with the books? It didn't have as much of an impact as I think it should have. And the same thing with the comics. What did you get? I like the idea that we're going to explore the Phasma thing, but wasn't that also announced at one point?
I had not personally heard that.
I don't know the comic was. I know the book was.
Okay.
The book definitely was, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, you knew everything was kind of coming already, right?
I mean, yeah, there wasn't anything that stood out hugely to me. I think there was one that they announced that I didn't, maybe I missed this one, the book that they're doing leading up to, episode 8.
Well, they're doing, what they are doing.
The journey
is,
to.
What they did, this is for Lucasfilm, I think, but so the journey to The Force Awakens they did, and now they're going to do Journey to the Last Jedi, which is very interesting.
Yeah.
And I think they pointed this out in.
That there's no break.
There's really no break.
Yeah.
And I think that Star Wars News Net pointed this out, that's interesting. Like but there is kind of a break, if you think about it, because while those events are happening, and you know, just a short time period from Rey flying over to see Luke, like what's going on in the interim with other places
Leia
too. So
and
there are things. Yeah.
Yeah. So that one was the most interesting one to me because I kind of did think they wouldn't do much there because there wasn't much time. So that one's the one that I was like, I want to check that out. Not that I don't want to read the other ones, but I was like, oh, this is interesting.
What do you think, Riley?
You know, being somewhat outside of the books and not totally diving in and immersing myself, but with examples, but like Lost Stars I loved, Bloodline I loved. There are books that came out like Inferno Squad mm-hmm. that surprised me because tailored to the Battlefront 2 video game announcement and then learning the story, I'm going to read that book.
The story sounds really cool.
So that looks great. Phasma doesn't really do it for me, just to be honest. I love the idea of the 40 from a certain point of view. I'm gonna go full into that one. So for me on the outside, I was like, these are great announcements because because I'm not following the books as much as you guys are. So I go, and so there are titles that come out, and especially Leia with Claudia Gray, I'm like, okay, these are the books I'm gonna go buy and read because that's when those are the ones that are speaking to me. So it was exciting announcements for me.
Mr. Ken,
I love all of this, gonna read all of it, yay.
Wait, were you guys at the panel?
No,
we couldn't get a chance to about it. So David Griffin went to the panel for us, and you know, he said the same thing. He just came back.
Hey Griff, what'd you think?
yeah,
it's great. Hey, speaking of Lost Stars, what about this story here?
I was going to switch.
Lost Stars is getting a manga adaptation. Claudia Gray's very popular, our favorite here, YA. But I put quotation marks around that because it is really just a damn good Star Wars story. Mm-hmm. You're going to be able to get it in.
How do you feel about it, you grouchy little weasel? Oh,
I love it. It makes me not grouchy.
Okay, good. I'm going to talk to Tiffany here about this, and then we're going to move on to Twitter here, because that's what I was going to do, but Ken decides he just wants to run the show the way he wants to run it.
Yep,
so,
that's what I do here.
Good Tiffany, man.
What?
How do you feel about this?
About what?
All right, next story.
Oh, about the manga?
Yeah.
Lost Stars? Oh, I thought you kept looking at your laptop like you were about to read something to me, and I was like, what are you going to read? I'm really excited about it. I think I love the fact that like so many new characters get posted, and I get so many tweets that like, is that Tiffany? Like the Battlefront trailer came out, and everyone was like, I swore that was you. And the same thing with Lost Stars.
We'll have a big announcement for you later, won't we?
Yep.
Huh? Sorry. What? Did I blow it? No.
But seeing the like manga version of it, it's reading the book initially, I was like, God, that would be a character I'd want to play. And then seeing the manga come out, I was like, oh, I want to be her so bad. So I think that they're getting to do another version. They realize how excited the fans were about that particular story, and then they're trying it out in different kind of avenues. Yeah. Makes me excited because who knows what that could lead to.
Yeah. All right, now we're going to get to that section of the show where we are talking to you guys and how we do it every week. You hashtag Collider Jedi Council on Twitter. We go through them. We pick out some of your questions, and we answer them. Ken, what do you got?
Christian, this is a great idea to go to this segment.
Thank you.
First one up. This
you mean
is
category.
From Ian. Category. Great category. He says, hey, what's the one thing that has to be in The Last Jedi?
That's not it. Thanks, Cody.
And would disappoint you if it wasn't.
I just after hearing Cody on certain shows, like he works so hard.
Cody
on the
hates
thing.
Us.
No, he hates us. When he gets to a point where when like you call out something else and you call it one of his mistakes, he hates you for like a minute. He just he hates us right
He'll
now.
He'll cut you. So yeah. Ian says, what's the one thing that needs to be in The Last Jedi and would disappoint you if it wasn't, Christian?
Okay, is that the right one, Cody?
Yes.
All right.
There were two from Ian.
All right.
Ian number one.
Well, Ian's a good guy. What's the one thing? I think Luke with a lightsaber.
Exactly.
You gotta have Luke fighting with the saber. If Luke isn't fighting with the saber for at least a little bit, the green saber just goes and wrecks shop, I'll be a little disappointed.
That's exactly what I was going to say. If Luke does not fight, hold, use a lightsaber at some point in this movie, I would be very disappointed.
I agree with you guys. I'm going to go, since you mentioned it, a reunion with Leia. We got to see that because you fooled me once, right? I got to see Leia and Luke come together, and that's going
to
be huge.
You would be really I would like to see that, but I would be upset if I didn't see him with a lightsaber.
Yeah,
And I'm saying that's my number one.
Yeah. Yeah.
But since you guys mentioned it, I'm going to say Luke and Leia coming together, and I need to hear that theme from John Williams.
The only reason, though, I'd be a little bit more forgiving on that one is because in my mind I'm going to be thinking, oh, man, they probably had the reunion set up for Episode 9. You know,
I don't know.
Yeah, Ken.
The Luke with the lightsaber. Not just igniting the green, but getting into some action is what I really want. But really, really, it's at one point I want Admiral Akbar to say, "It's like my old friend Radis said," and quotes Radis in battle. I'm kidding. No, it's Luke with the lightsaber.
Right. What's next?
Let's go to the second Ian question. You want to go to the second one, Christian?
Well,
Ian checks
how
in and says,
"Cody out." Let Cody just put it up there.
Yeah, Cody, you just pop something out. This is about Rian Johnson revealing why Kylo Ren's scar has changed, because that's a big thing in Star Wars fandom. We love taking little tiny things and having too much fun with it. Are the changes important to overall canon, Ian asks Christian.
Overall canon, no, it's not overly important. I think he should have stuck with it. I think he should have, you know, J.J. Abrams said that's where the scar is, and that's where the scar should have been. It's not going to make me not see the movie, and it's not going to make me go, oh, I can't concentrate on this scene because his scar is in a different place. Mm-hmm. And I respect his decision to say, this is my movie, this is what I want to do. But I do think that he should have stuck with the original scar.
I agree with you. At the same time, I'm like, maybe there was so much, like when they were doing makeup testing, it's like maybe they did stuff and it was just weird, like when he was making facial expressions or it became distracting. And so he's like, we just need to move it. Like, and there's no way to explain that. There's no way to say, oh, well, he moved it using the fork?
Right.
So just be like, it was distracting, so we moved it. I didn't want it going straight up his nose.
That's a good point. Riley around?
This is too much for me. I can't. I don't care.
You don't care. Okay.
No, it's too much of a
nerdy story. You don't care. Ken.
Scars fade and change, I guess. I will see. You know, when you're getting a back to tank, you don't know what happens to scars.
Exactly.
It's true.
But it was an issue for Star Wars fans. I get a good question. Ian, next question from Ben. Is it possible we'll see a movie set between Return of the Jedi and The Force Awakens with Alden Ehrenreich's Han Solo and a new Luke?
I love this question. I love it, I love it, I love it, I love it, because I think of Sebastian Stan playing young Luke. Now, whether or not that will happen, probably not. But it would be great.
Like, and the age would be wrong.
Not really.
He would...
No, actually, would fit pretty perfectly.
Was Sebastian a little bit older?
Older than
he looks older than Ehrenreich.
Yeah,
he does.
Ehrenreich, yeah, but I mean,
but he's saying it would be with Ehrenreich.
Well, the two of them too, but it depends on. I mean, it depends. I mean, look again. It would depend. When are we setting this? And make look. There's a certain scene of a certain movie I just saw just now, like not too long ago, and the makeup on this particular person made this person look very, very young, and I bought it.
Yeah.
So you can age someone up a little bit too if you needed to, but I don't think you need to. But the point is, I think that if this Han Solo hits and they're able to make a young Luke, then I think that they could explore that, but it's not going to be easy. Mm-hmm. They've got to really get two people in there that the fans go, okay, we can say that that's new Han and that's new Luke. What do you think?
It depends to me if what the success of this Han Solo standalone movie does. Mm-hmm. If an entire generation of fans, young and old, entire generations of fans, young and old, take to a new Han Solo in this type of capacity that's not just a cameo in another film, then I think you might have something. I don't know if I would necessarily want that. I think I've been talking about a animated show with Luke and Lor San Tekka going around the galaxy. That kind of works a little bit more for me than this. But nothing's impossible at this point.
I love this idea, too. I really do, because I think there's so much story to mine, especially, I know they're talking here, Han and Luke. Why did Luke walk away? I think that's the biggest mystery. We're probably going to get it in Last Jedi, but I would love to see in live action Lor San Tekka and Luke going around, and I think it's a fantastic idea. Yeah.
I think it totally depends on how people respond to Han in this new movie.
Right.
Because we're going to get Han, and we're going to get Lando, and if the chemistry doesn't work there and people feel weird about seeing young versions of them, I don't think it's going to be something that people are like, yes, let's try it again with him and Luke. But if the response is super positive and we are all 100% on board, then yeah, of course I would want to see that happen, because then it's like, okay, we already like our Han, let's get a new Luke.
It's so funny, like as we're doing this, someone just tweeted me out this picture of young Sebastian Stan, and it looks just like Mark Hamill. I just retweeted it. Look at this.
Yeah, he does.
It's crazy. So we'll see what happens. I mean, I don't think it's going to be anytime soon, so who the hell knows? Ken, what? You know what? Cody, what's next? There you go.
Hey, Gray Jedi 28 says, hey, Christian, will we ever get a Palpatine standalone film or just story? If so, gangster type or politics like a House of Cards, what do you got?
Will we ever get it? I doubt it. Would I ever want to see it? Tomorrow. But I actually think that a Palpatine movie actually serves better as a television show. Mm-hmm. I think because it's very hard to have a standalone film with the bad guy as the lead guy. It is a lot easier to do a television show with the lead being a bad guy and the rise and the stuff happening behind. I think there could be so much that could be done in a Palpatine television series that I hope is something that they've talked about. It would be really cool because you could have so much in the age of, like, starts out in, like, right towards the events of Revenge of the Sith, and the politics would still be there, the Jedi would still be there, and then leading into the events of what happened in Revenge of the Sith, and you could have a couple seasons, and then, you know, ultimately ending with his demise in Return of the Jedi. It could be an actually great, great series that I hope could happen.
I love that idea, too, for, like, Netflix or any streaming service. HBO comes to mind, but I would go back to how since Darth Plagueis is not canon anymore.
He's canon.
The book, I mean. His rise. I'm talking Palpatine becoming a Sith.
Yeah.
So start it before Phantom Menace, even farther back, and then you can run through. Maybe there's, like, you know, the storyline, so things pick up of things we know from the movies, and then we go off and we see him do his thing. That's a great idea. I love that.
It immediately makes me think of Game of Thrones.
Yep.
Just because of
the politics that you would get to see. And I think that that was where, you know, even in Bloodline, where it's like you're reading that one and you get to see so much of how the politics works, and it works well in a book.
Right.
If they were to take that to a TV show, I would be so on board for it. I think in a movie, it's really hard because you go and you only have a certain amount of time. You want action. You also want to get the story, but the politics stuff moves so slowly. And, you know, someone like Littlefinger, it's like stuff happens behind the scenes. And I feel like those would be things that would happen with Palpatine and everything going on that I would 100% want to see.
What do you think, Ken?
I would definitely be interested in the story. You know how much I love the Darth Plagueis book. I think a show is a good idea. I think a James Luceno novel is a good idea. I don't see it being the focal point of a movie, like you said, but it could definitely be part of a rich tapestry in a new Star Wars standalone movie.
All right, let's do one more.
Well, good. It's the last one.
Oh,
this
good.
Is from Chris. Hey, guys. Could Rey be a Dameron? Force tree in Shattered Empire? Poe seems to be force sensitive. What's your take?
I don't think it's a crazy theory. I don't think it's a crazy theory at all. I think that they always have these kind of big reveals in Star Wars some way or another. There hasn't been any interactions so far we've seen with the two of them. I know that they had some kind of interaction in the novel, I think. And I think at one point there was kind of conversation.
Like,
or were they going to be
flirtation, I thought.
Love interest?
A little bit.
So it's one of two things. I think that they're going to have some kind of interaction for sure. I'm going to tell you why I don't think that they're related. It's because originally Poe was supposed to be killed off, like, right away. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that it was ever the plan unless they kind of did eventually what George Lucas did. It's like, oh, yeah, I should be his father, and which is possible. But I'm going to say it's a low percentage at about 15% with a higher percentage at around 45% that they're love interest.
Mm-hmm. I feel like because of the fact that we had the little chemistry in the book, I think it was, that it would be doing the same thing again if they were to be like brother and sister related in some way, where it's like, oh, they flirted, but guess what? You're related. It's awkward now.
Right.
That if people were like flustered or uncomfortable, weren't too happy about the reboot of like doing another version of A New Hope, I feel like that would be the same thing all over again. So I don't want that. I don't think it would be a bad thing, like if they're like cousins or something or related in some way, but brother and sister, no. I would be shocked if they were blood brother and sister related.
Let's go with related first.
Related, I would say 41%.
Whoa, that,
no, 36%.
That's pretty high. What about love interest?
7%.
Whoa, even lower. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, Riley.
I look, if they are related, i.e., brother and sister, then you're going to get all the people that thought Force Awakens was a remake of New Hope saying the same thing about this. So I think they're not going to go there. A lot of reasons too. I think because of what you said, Christian, that Poe was supposed to die. I like the idea of a cousin. I don't know. I want the romance. So give me the romance. I think that would be interesting to see.
No, she's supposed to be with Finn, guys.
No, Finn's going to be with Kelly Marie.
I think so. Yep. I think what Finn said, what John Boyega said, is that Rose is a big fan of Finn. He's a hero to her. So that might be an interesting dynamic to see. And then we never know. We don't know what the Jedi code's going to be because a Jedi can't have attachment. What did Luke do? Why is he alone on this island? If we're going to go prequel and say, oh, you're not supposed to be attached, you're not supposed to, you know, marry and have kids and all these things, what is that going to mean for Rey? So is she going to have a romance? I kind of hope so. Be nice to see. I don't know.
I'm doing some research on the fly. The Shattered Empire 4-issue comic series is great, by the way. You definitely should read it. Shara Bey is an interesting character, very close with Luke, helps Luke on some things. Kes Dameron, Poe, it looks very much like Kes Dameron. There, you could look at some of the images of Shara Bey from the comic and say, yeah, there's some Rey resemblance there. Who knows what happens? But, you know, she... I don't want to spoil anything from some of the stories, I should say. I do not think Shara Bey gave birth to Rey, and I don't think Rey's part of that family.
No. All right. Well, that's it. That's our show, and it was a nice one. I'm glad we all are back, and I can't wait to just explore more of the Star Wars news as we get closer and closer to The Last Jedi. We're going to right around the corner from D23. It's really not that far away. It's July. It's coming up. Then Comic-Con. A lot of stuff happening here. So join us on our journey to the Force Awakens.
Sure.
We did that already.
Go back
Let's go back to it. To the Last Jedi. Because there's going to be a lot of stuff coming out. But I'd like to thank the council today making her triumphant return. It was the Smith Lord. Tiffany Smith, where can they find you?
You guys can find me on social media at Tiffany's Tweets. And if you are excited about the Wonder Woman movie, make sure you're following me because I got to do a little set visit. I'm starting to post some of the pictures. We're going to do a video diary on Wonder Wednesdays. So follow me on social.
Nice. Mark Yodi Riley, the number one contender for the Schmodown, going back for that belt tomorrow. Besides that, where can they find you?
You can find me at Riley Round on Twitter and Instagram, talking smack to John Rocha, because I'm taking that belt. Do or do not. There is no try.
Very nice. Mr. Ken Knapsack, the pit boss, the reigning Schmodown Star Wars champion.
Yeah, man.
What do you got?
Yeah, a lot of people asking, is there a belt? Is there a belt?
There will be.
No, there should be a lightsaber.
The question is there a budget?
And, well,
there will be a belt, yes.
Because the writer's room, we want all the belts.
The records.
All the records, all the belts, right?
Absolutely. You can follow me at CatNapSuck for all my adventures. Thanks again to everyone who came out and spent some time out of your busy schedule with us at Star Wars Celebration. It was a lot of fun.
And for me, you can find me at Christian Harloff on Twitter and Instagram every Thursday right here. And like I mentioned before, make sure you check out the Star Wars Movie Trivia Schmodown that is on the channel right now, the Jedi Council panel from Celebration. That's on there. Lots of stuff that we have. Everything Star Wars that you want to see from Collider is on the channel. Subscribe here. Thank you guys for joining us, and may the Force be with you, always.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.